听朋友大家好，2019台北时装周 Vogue 全球购物业国际时尚论坛即将开始，让我们欢迎论坛计划主持人，现任职于香港中文大学新闻传播学院的吴世嘉吴博士，欢迎吴博士上台。
副局长，然后我们 Vogue 方向的团队，还有现场的所有来宾女士先生，我们时尚界、设计界喜欢时尚的朋友们，大家早。
好。
我是吴世嘉。谢谢刚才开场的时候做一个简单的自我介绍。我现在在香港工作，我在香港中文大学，教上 EMBA 的课程，但是我是嫁上台湾人。所以你会觉得我没有香港口音，是因为我几年前搬到香港去。那今天很荣幸呢，可以借由这个机会，跟我们文化局还有跟 Vogue 一起合作来策划今天的论坛。那为什么叫做计划主持人？也就是说，我今天不是主持人，就是所谓的司仪的角色，而是呢，希望透过我们今天整个的论坛的一个规划设计跟我们的讲者内容，可以带给我们所有现场观众，大家可以理解到未来接下来我们碰到时尚的挑战是什么，未来的走向是什么。另外呢，还有一个重点就是说，我们也希望。透过这样的一个平台，我们这次的所有的讲者都从世界各地飞来，所以呢，有从欧洲的，然后有从香港的，也有从这个美国的各地方来。我们就希望透过这样的一个平台，可以跟大家做最深浅的一个交流。那么，来说明一下我们今天的一个流程，也就是说，我们今天上半场会有两位我们的演讲者，下半场会有两位。那上半场呢，我们特别请到的是我们 Vogue 这边的 This International 的最重要的一个角色，待会来跟大家做一个分享。那另外呢，我们请到了设计师黄琦来跟大家来分享，他怎么样从设计师的角色转换成。所谓做 sustainable fashion， 也就是所谓永续时尚的部分。那我们也是希望说，透过今天的这样一个主场的主题的定位，可以把新思维，然后未来的趋势，可以转换成我们下一步的一个能量，呼应我们今天的主题“下一站台北 ”（Next Generation）。那回到我们的主题，也就是今天时尚的下一步，我们要怎么走？时尚的新秩序在哪里？那么好。现在呢，我们首先就请我们的文化局的副局长陈勋副局长来为我们说几句话，我们来欢迎他。
各位贵宾，各位好朋友，大家早安。今天很开心，虽然是双十连假，可是呢，我们现场满满的座无虚席，然后大家都精神奕奕的来参加今天的国际时尚论坛。那我想，时装是展演一个城市文化、生活、美学的重要的窗口。它跟我们的日常生活息息相关，每天起床的第一件事情要面对的一个问题。那时装周呢，就是一个城市在一个城市种下了一个创意的种子。那每年的9月、10月，其实在全球四大的国际时装周都陆续的登场，展现隔一年春夏的一个流行新的趋势。那我们开心台北也没有缺席，跟 Vogue 举办台北时装周今年迈入了第二届。我们除了有时尚大秀，然后有跟百货通路结合的快闪店，我们希望可以连接产业之外。最重要的是今天我们有这样子的一个国际论坛，那很开心，就是邀请到国内外重量级的讲师来跟我们分享2020的一个大趋势。那还会讲到包括循环设计以及跟电商合作的一些案例。我们希望透过这样子跨域的一些对谈跟交流，可以体现时尚更多更多的可能性。那除此之外呢，我们在明天在松山文创园区即将有时尚 时装大秀的这样一个压轴活动的登场。我们会把台湾八个品牌的设计他们的创意展现在大家的面前，同时会结合了数位艺术以及流行音乐这样子的一些展演，把这样子的好的作品呈现在大家的眼前。所以大家除了参与今天的论坛之外，也希望明天我们在同学见。那再次谢谢各位的莅临，希望大家今天经过一天的论坛的洗礼，都可以有满满的收获。谢谢大家。
谢谢我们的话局陈副局长。接下来呢，我们还要请到我们这一次的活动的一个重要的主人，也就是 Vogue 服饰总经理刘正之吉彦来上台，跟我们大家说几句话。欢迎吉彦。
陈副局长还有我们的计划主持人吴博士，还有从世界各地人到来的各位讲者们，大家好，大家早。我相信大家知道，康奈纳斯在全球的这个时装周里面，通常都是扮演所谓的媒体的伙伴的角色。其实康奈纳斯中也担任很多品牌设计师，甚至百货通路，还有这些这个强化产业发展这样的合作的一个角色。大家可能不知道，就是英国伦敦的这个时装周，其实伦敦周的主席就是 GQ 的总编辑 Dylan Jones， 然后在美国还有英国。我们的这个 Vogue 也都跟当地的时尚协会做出了所谓的这个时尚的创业的基金哦，来帮助更多的年轻人能够这样子在这个设计产业做发展。那今天很荣幸 Vogue 再一次跟台北市政府有这样的合作，因为 Vogue 全球购物业在台湾做了11年了，这是一个还蛮不太容易的事情。这11年来，我们从来没有间断过。那很多人问我说，就是为什么要花费那么大的这个心力啊、物力啊、资源啊、时间啊，要把活动规模像一年比一年搞那么大。那我自己是觉得 Vogue 有一些很重要的这个使命，我觉得必须要来这个共同来参与的。第一，我觉得很重要的是所谓的国际化。那大家知道时装周不太能只关注所谓的台湾的时尚的产业，时装周必须要能够也跟这个国际的时尚产业接轨。那让台北市能够变成是一个更所谓的国际化的都市，所以大家可以看到，在这一次的论坛上面，我们请到很多这个国际的讲者，还有在这个动态秀上面，在品牌跨界的合作上面，我们都邀请了很多的国际品牌参与。那所以让台北的这个时装周不是只是这个关注在台湾的时尚而已，而是能够让国际能够更关注到台湾，也能够让台湾能够学习到国际。这是一个我觉得这个很重要的一个事情。第二个事情，我觉得是尽量能够让民众有感，能够让年轻人参与，我觉得这是很重要的一个事情。那我们过去曾经说，就是时尚这个距离大家很遥远哦。那这个但透过我们这一次很多活动上面的这个操作跟安排，就像刚刚可以看到那个我们请到 OZ 来做这一支 MV， 还有我们做了很多这种数位上面的操作，比如说我们用 AR 的这个时尚的相框，还有这个社群上面的一个时尚的学院，都透过这些数位社群上面的这个安排，能够让年轻人更有感。而且很重要的一个事情是，背后做这些这个事项的团队其实都是年轻人，所以我们也这个透过这样的一个平台，能够让更多的年轻人能够参与到这个里面。那第三个我觉得很重要的是帮助产业还有商圈的发展。大家知道信义区已经是这个应该算是全台湾最密集的这样一个商业的地方。那通过我们在这边做了很多的这样的活动，不是只有台北101，还有包括香堤，甚至在北港塔，我希望大家待会有空的时候可以去看一看。我们帮这一次入选的8位设计师做了这样的一个快闪店，也帮助他们做这个线上的销售。那透过这样的一个机制，我希望是真的能够促进这个产业还有商圈的发展。那也谢谢文化部的支持，我们把这一次的场域从新一区扩展到新一区跟松烟，扩展到这个大稻埕、永乐市场，甚至所谓的大直，就是让能够更多的这个商圈能够参与到这一次的时装周的活动。那最后就是特别谢谢市政府的这个支持。那也谢谢很多的这个讲者，还有各位的伙伴。那没有大家的这个支持，没有大家的坚持，我相信这一次的 谢谢大家，也谢谢大家今天过来这次的论坛，谢谢。
好，谢谢今天的专业讲座，刘蓓台长，谢谢。接下来我们要进行一下呢，我们今天的主办单位跟这个讲者合照，所以呢，我今天先请我们康奈纳市全球版 Vogue Business 的总编 Gloria Ebert please come up. We have a group photo. The Fashion Clinic 的创办人王琦小姐，我们小四研发创办人兼执行长王先志，还有呢，我们的陈副局长和范局长，大家一起来合照。现在呢，我要来为大家介绍我们今天的第一位的讲者 Lauren。Lauren 呢，他的经验非常的丰富，他曾经这个担任就是在参与 Vogue 之前，他担任过纽约的凡士金亚的总编辑，而且他参加过全世界各地的大小型的会议跟大学的演讲超过100场。那么他现在担任 Vogue International 的这个business总编辑。那他也常常在世界各地观察各地的时尚的趋势，所以呢，我们现在就可以请我们的现场观众给 Lauren 最热烈的掌声，欢迎他今天的分享。好 ，Lauren please。
We work with more than 800 fashion journalists in our 32 Condé Nast markets around the world to provide a truly global perspective on the fashion industry. You can find us on VogueBusiness.com, sign up for our newsletter. You can find us on Instagram, and starting later this year, you will also find us in Mandarin on WeChat. So, yes, these are 32 markets that we work with.So today I'm going to talk about 10 trends that are set to shape and transform the fashion and luxury industries in 2020. Now, the thing that all the Western press is talking about right now is bracing for an economic slowdown, particularly in North America and Europe. As you can see in this chart, luxury has had an incredible decade of growth. And growth is still very strong.LVMH reported earlier this week that sales were up 16% for the first 9 months of 2019. But the environment is becoming more challenging. Economic growth is contracting in the world's largest luxury goods market, which is the U.S. And there are also concerns that the U.S. economy could enter a recession as soon as 2021. Rod Sides, who is the vice chairman at Deloitte,told Vogue Business recently that there isn't one client that he works with that doesn't have a plan for a U.S. recession. How prepared they are, he said, is very different. So the U.S. is not alone. Economic growth in Japan is also slowing. Japan is the world's second largest luxury goods market. So it's set to have from 0.9% to 0.4% next year, according to IMF. Europe is also slowing.So, contrary to popular belief, luxury is not immune to recessions. When the U.S. entered the Great Recession of 2008, Bert Tansey, the president of the famous American department store Neiman Marcus, He said, when our customer tightens their belt, it's generally ostrich or alligator. That ultimately proved false, and Bert was not in his job anymore by 2010. What we saw in the U.S. was that the crisis led to a boom in lower-priced clothes and discount outlets like TJ Maxx and Saks OFF 5TH. You know, it's been 11 years, and actually, shoppers still shop that way. But, you know, the good news is that luxury is, you know, was not as impacted as other industries, and it recovered very quickly. So, you know, as you can see in the chart, the last economic downturn shaved 9% off the value of the global luxury goods industry. But thanks to rapid growth in China and Southeast Asia, it will return to growth just 2 years later. The good news also is that brands are better prepared for a recession than they were a decade ago. They've got better inventory controls, and they sell less to department stores and more through their own channels. And, there are going to be challenges in the U.S. and Europe over the next year, but luxury is still going to grow. And thanks to China, India, and Southeast Asia, whose economies are set to grow between 6 and 7% next year. These regions have already powered most of the luxury expansion in the last decade, with the Chinese alone now accounting for about one-third of luxury spending globally. By 2025, nearly one in every two luxury goods purchased will be to a Chinese person. So the Chinese are buying more luxury goods than ever before, but where they are buying is changing. So after years of spending their money in Hong Kong and in Paris, luxury shopping is increasingly taking place on the mainland. Purchases in mainland China grew twice as much as purchases abroad between 2015 and 2018, according to Bain. So what's driving that shift? First, luxury products are not as expensive in China as they used to be, thanks to a drop in currency value, which has made products more expensive abroad, cuts in import tariffs, and an increase in tax-free allowance on international e-commerce purchases. And, of course, aside from tax policy, the government has also passed new laws against Daigou, which has been a further boon to international e-commerce players. But this is just the beginning of the shift. You can see in this chart, right now the U.S. and Europe account for almost a third of the luxury goods market globally. Look, fast forward to 2025, and you now have sales in China almost at parity with the Americas and Europe. This is going to have a huge impact on brands' entire retail networks, and tourism revenue, and on luxury meccas like Hong Kong and Paris. So the other thing we're watching very closely is brands are responding to climate change. The world's becoming more concerned about climate change, and the fashion industry is coming under the spotlight with the harsh toll clothing and footwear have on the environment. And fairly so. More than 8% of all global greenhouse gas emissions are produced by the apparel and footwear industries. That's a lot. Nearly three-fifths of all clothing ends up in a landfill or burned within just 1 year of being purchased. And around 20 to 25% of all the chemical compounds produced globally, they're used by the textile finishing industry. So for the last 2 weekends at London Fashion Week, anytime you try to get into a show, it has been thronged with protesters from Extinction Rebellion who have asked the industry to start producing less and change its ways. Governments are taking action as well. Last year, the British government proposed a 1p fast fashion tax on every garment made and sold in the UK, which they would then use to fund donation and recycling programs. It was ultimately rejected, but it is a sign of more government regulation to come. So many brands from fast fashion to luxury are getting ahead of governments, and they're working to cut emissions and waste on their own. H&M has launched conscious collections and recycling programs in store. Designer Gabriella Hearst, who is now backed by LVMH, recently held the first carbon-neutral fashion show at New York Fashion Week. She only cast local models. She didn't cast any models who've flown in relocated to New York by plane. Gucci's gone one step further. They recently announced that they are an entirely carbon neutral brand. The company is in the midst of a 10-year plan to slash its carbon emissions in half by 2025. And in the meantime, it's donating 8.5 million euros a year to preserve forests in order to mitigate the emissions it can't currently remove from its supply chain. So just about every designer I speak to now is trying to produce more efficiently and cut down waste. This is designer Emily Bode, who was nominated for the LVMH Prize. She's based in New York. There are so many others, like Bethany Williams in London. They are producing collections entirely made of just dead stock fabric, so fabric that fashion brands don't want or aren't using. Very cheap as well. Or they're finding vintage fabrics in stores and upcycling them to create new clothes. And it's, also, I should say, it's not just the small brands that are doing this. Marnie at this Milan Fashion Week show also did a number of upcycle looks. Brands are also thinking more of the life cycle of their products after sale. So they're thinking, you know, typically a brand like Burberry, their journey with the customer ended when they sold you a trench coat. But now they're thinking about, okay, well, what happens to that trench coat after we sold it? They recently partnered with a resale website called The Real Real to incentivize their customers to start, if they had a Burberry trench coat or a bag or a shoe that they're not wearing, they are now giving customers vouchers in exchange for putting that up on a resale website so that it can continue to be used in the economy. I think one of the most exciting things that I've seen is from Patagonia, which now on its website you can buy not only new products from Patagonia, you can also buy goods that have already been worn, that have been donated back to Patagonia, that they have repaired and refurbished and are now selling for slightly less. It's not just big brands that are doing this. The London label has two Portuguese designers called Marques Almeida. They are also launching this on their website next year. I think this is absolutely something every brand should be doing. So as brands try to cut down on emissions and waste, they are turning away from toxic materials to new, more environmentally friendly materials. One of the most popular is something called Econil. It is now being used to make all products nylon bags. You can see that your left. And then Burberry is now using it in a lot of its trench coat designs. This is nylon that's made from, you know, unused fishing nets from old carpet. It's been incredibly popular. We're also seeing the rise of vegan fashion. As consumers become increasingly concerned about animal welfare and the impact that animals have on the environment. In the UK, the number of products described as vegan rose 75% in the last 12 months alone. According to Edited, it grew 320% in Denmark. The global synthetic leather market, so vegan leather, is currently valued at $25 billion and is projected to reach $45 billion by 2025. So historically, vegan fashion is not that new. I mean, historically, fast fashion brands like Zara have used PVC and other sort of plastic materials to sort of simulate the look of leather. But these aren't very environmentally friendly. So now we're seeing fashion houses are really searching for alternatives to leather that are a lot more environmentally friendly. One of the most exciting new entrants in the market is something called Pinatex, which is made from pineapple leaf waste from the Philippines and is now being used by Hugo Boss. And there are many others in development, including a leather-like material made from apple waste. Oh, so I should also say, in this last slide, both of these products, the Stella McCartney trench coat, this is a leather bag, and neither of those were made from leather. Fifth trend, what we call the end of ownership. So growing up in the US, I was taught to invest in a wardrobe that I would wear my entire life. You buy a really nice coat, you wear it for 20 or 30 years. But increasingly, young people, younger millennials, and what we call Gen Z, they're no longer thinking that way. They don't own cars, they Uber, they don't buy houses as much. And increasingly, they're renting their wardrobes. But I was recently speaking to Eva Cruz, who runs the Copenhagen Fashion Summit, which is a big sustainability conference in Copenhagen every year. And she was telling me about her daughter who bought this Gucci phone case on the secondhand website for 160 euros. And she was like, why are you spending 160 euros on a phone case for a 16-year-old daughter? And she said, Mom, I'm not buying it. She's like, I'm going to, you know, use it for 6 months, and then I'm going to sell it again on the website. So really, I'm renting it for 40 euros. That's just a whole different way of thinking about a wardrobe, which is something that it's not based on new demand or newness, but something that you're going to own temporarily and love and then put back into the system. So in the West, especially in America, there's been a proliferation of companies that are trying to formalize this where you can actually rent wardrobes. This is led by a company called Rent the Runway. It was launched 9 years ago as a way for women who are going to weddings or parties, and they didn't want to be seen on Instagram wearing the same dress twice. Well, they could go to Rent the Runway, they could wear a dress once for like $100 and then return it afterwards. More recently, they've now launched a Netflix-like subscription service where for it's $89 a month, you can rent any four items from their website. You choose your goods online, they ship them to you, and any time if you don't want to wear one of those goods, you ship it back, or you drop it off at a drop-off point in the store, and then you can just go ahead and pick two new items to wear. We've also seen a proliferation of secondhand luxury sites where you can buy, obviously, secondhand Gucci bags or Lanvin for a lot less. The RealReal is the biggest in the U.S. It's now publicly traded. Vestiaire Collective is very popular in Europe. In the East, rental resale is also starting to take off. 38 million Chinese used online resale platforms in 2017, which is up from 1.5 million in 2014. So that's 1.5 million to 38 million in just 1 year. The number one reason that they're turning to secondhand websites is, no surprise, because it's cheaper. So led by China, Asian spending on rented apparel online will increase an estimated 11.4% annually between 2017 and 2023. Like their mono counterparts in the West, China's post-90s generation faces growing competition in the labor market, rising house prices, and mounting household debt. At the same time, the desire to display their lifestyle on social media and the pressure of keeping up with fashion trends fuels the need for a faster turnover of outfits. So in the U.S., the rental market, like companies like Rent the Runway, it's driven mostly by the need for fancy clothes for party dresses. But in China, startups like Alibaba-backed Y Closet have focused instead on everyday clothes. Next trend is about stores getting smart. So companies have been investing in artificial intelligence, or AI, to make their websites more personal and responsive. A website like Net-a-Porter, if you're logged in, it knows what you're clicking, what you're buying, and the products that you now see on this webpage. It's not the same webpage that everyone's seeing. It's actually tailored to you. As you, Net-a-Porter CEO Federico Marchetti said recently, Net-a-Porter no longer has one homepage, but 3 million. So now that same technology that has been making websites so much smarter and more personal is being brought into stores. So last year, Kering, which is the parent company of Gucci, ran a really interesting AI experiment in one of its brands. Now, it came up with a list of all of the shoppers who had come in the last few months and bought an item from this brand. And it was like, okay, we're going to invite a group of shoppers into our store, give them a gift, invite them to look at the new collection, and then we'll see who buys more. And they said they gave the opportunity both to an algorithm, so the algorithm could choose the 7 people to invite, and then they gave it also to their personal store assistants, and they said, you can choose 7 people. And if you want to guess who was better at predicting which customers were going to buy something, it was the algorithm. And in fact, the algorithm identified customers who were twice as likely to buy something in the next 3 months. So they're now going to start rolling this program out to other stores. Other retailers like Levi's, they're using RFID chips, so radio frequency identification chips, and AI software from Datego to help merchandisers figure out where to place items in store. Levi's, the number one reason people leave without buying something is because they can't find their size. So they've been using this software to figure out where to place things so that people can find them and then reorder items that are coming out of stock. But actually, you know, where we're seeing the most innovative use of AI in stores is definitely in the East, thanks to facial recognition technology, which has not been widely adopted yet in the West. Probably many of you saw this, but Alibaba and Guess did a pop-up in Hong Kong last year where you had the option of signing in at the store, either using Taobao or a facial scan. This gave shoppers access to all their personal shopping history. So instead of going up to them in the store and saying, how can I help you, the question, they could just offer more personalized service because they already have that shopper's name and information and what they bought in the past. The store also actually, during the pop-up, was able to collect a lot of data about consumers. They used gyro sensors to see which garments they touched and what colors are most popular, and this informed what they designed in the future. So human bodies have changed dramatically over the past decade. I'm not saying it here, but in the U.S., where I'm from, more than one-third of adults are now classified as obese, and many more are overweight. But Europe's not that far behind. In Malta, UK, Hungary, and Lithuania, the obesity rate is now more than 1 in 4 adults. So in the U.S., 68% of women are now considered plus size, so that's a size 14 or above. But only 0.6% of luxury apparel and 10% of mass apparel is designed to fit them, according to analysis from Edited. That's a huge gap in the market. So designers who already extend their sizing ranges are cashing in because the plus size market is going to be worth $5.6 billion in 2020. So this is a designer named Tommy Taylor. She's based in New York. And she produces a lot of $500 for what we consider contemporary formal print dresses. She launched a plus-size collection called, I think it was Extended Plus, in 2017, which quickly became a hit. It was included U.S. sizes from 14 to 22, and she has since seen a 12% increase in overall wholesale just thanks to introducing plus sizes. Extended sizing now represents about 20% of all of her online sales, and it's only 20% of her total offer, but it's actually 35% of her sales. Return rates are also much, much lower on her plus-size items. Trend number 8, performance wear, is in the new streetwear. Streetwear is still growing. We are seeing better and better growth for sneakers all the time. But another area that luxury companies especially are zoning in on is performance wear, so things like puffer jackets, and fleece vests, and backpacks, and $800 hiking boots. The U.S. market for outdoor apparel is now valued at over $6.7 billion, which is up from $5.1 billion in 2013. So we're seeing similar jumps in the U.K. and other markets in Europe. This is not because people are hiking more. This is because people are starting to wear clothing they used to wear hiking or camping every day on the streets. I talk to companies like Burberry, and they look at the success of a brand like Montclair, which had $1.4 billion in sales last year, and Canada Goose, and they are now thinking, okay, there's an opportunity for us to play here. We can start creating our own sort of performance wear, puffer jackets. And because they're so technically impressive, they can charge thousands of dollars for them. So there is a downside to this, which is actually clothes like this are really difficult to make, so they don't have the same margins that, say, like sunglasses or denim have. There's also a lot of competition from, current outdoor brands like the North Face, which has been super savvy in partnering with brands like Le Garçon, Supreme, and Rayburn, and Christopher Rayburn in the last few years. Retailers are reducing returns. Free shipping, free returns has become the absolute standard for e-commerce. But for many retailers, this is so expensive and it is not sustainable. Germany is the highest return rate in Europe. 50% of everything ordered online is returned. So some retailers like Amazon have actually begun banning shoppers who return too much clothing. I return a lot, so I'm really nervous about this personally. The number one reason shoppers return items is because they don't fit. So retailers like Zara and Zalando, which is based in Germany, they are using fit models. So now every single thing they sell, they're putting it on a fit model right from the point it arrives. And they're telling shoppers where it fits tight, where it's too loose, whether the size of the label actually matches the way it's going to fit. So Zalando is actually doing this, and it's been a considerable investment, has reduced their return rate by 4%. So other companies like Adidas and Gap own athletic wear brand Athleta are using data gathered from body scanners which have been placed in gyms around the world. This is helping them understand different body sizes and shapes in different countries, and they're now passing that information on to their design team so that they can design clothes that fit better. So this one is probably not going to happen in 2020, but it's a trend that I'm really excited about, which is the rise of digital clothing. So one of the reasons that consumers buy so much fast fashion is because they want to have new outfits to wear on social media. So there's a Scandinavian retailer called Carlings, and last year they had the idea of creating a virtual fashion collection. It was just made for Instagram. They made 19 generalist, sizeless pieces. They each cost between 10 and 30 euros, and each had a limited production run of 12, so they were rare. This is actually from the collection. So customers sent in a photo, and then the designers at Carlings, they then manipulated that photo so it looked like they were wearing that apparel. So that the photo in the middle, that's what the guy was actually wearing, and on the right is what they sent back to him. They hired several influencers to promote the collection, and it sold out entirely within a week. So, the idea of virtual fashion may seem really outlandish, but gamers have been spending real money on clothes for years. Glue Mobile's Covet fashion game lets players style models with digitally rendered designer clothing and accessories, and it brought in $53 million in sales last year. Kim Kardashian Hollywood game, which allows you to dress an avatar in clothing from Roberto Cavalli, from Balmain, from Karl Lagerfeld, generated more than $240 million in sales since its launch in 2014. Louis Vuitton is also dipping its toes into digital fashion waters. It recently became the first luxury brand to partner with the video game League of Legends, by offering in-game skins and a corresponding capsule collection designed by Nicolas Gaspier. There's also coming up in London a new app called Dress. It's from a former Net-a-Porter executive named Lucy Yeomans. And she's been working with lots of leading luxury brands on a sort of gaming app that allows you to dress an avatar in designer fashion and then go buy those items on Farfetch. And it will launch early next year. So I hope this gets you excited about some of the things that are coming in 2020. Thank you so much for inviting me to speak. It was a real pleasure. And also, just a reminder, we are launching on WeChat next year, so I hope you will follow us there. Thank you.
So it's Q&A session, so we have you to be in the center.现场的观众朋友们，你们可以先拿出你的手机，扫一下网页 QR code。要做什么呢？就是如果刚您听了 Lauren 的说明介绍之后呢，如果有问题，你可以扫了以后呢，就输入上去。所以呢，大家就不用害羞，担心你要拿个麦克风来问问题。OK， 那所以给大家一点时间提问。那我今天呢，先就刚才 Lauren 提的部分呢。So Laura, I'm going to ask you a few questions. Because you mentioned about the growth of East, right? The booming of East. So we are now in the East, we are now in Taiwan. Okay, so here we have a lot of brand representatives and designers here. So in terms of you know, the East culture and the East perspective, can you give us some of the you know, recommendations based on you know, the 10 you know, trends you observe?
Yeah, I mean, I'm certainly not an expert in this market, so I apologize. I think for me, one of the most exciting things I've seen, again, is this idea of taking clothes that have already been sold, bringing them back, repairing them, and selling them again. I mean, right now, we've seen this proliferation of these secondhand sites where customers are selling their used goods and they're making money, but brands right now aren't making any money from that process. So if a brand can do that, do something kind for the environment and make new revenue, that's a real opportunity. Digital clothing is probably a little too far afield right now, but again, I think if a fast fashion retailer as small as Carling's can innovate in this space, there are definitely opportunities for brands to be real leaders here.
Okay, so here comes a very interesting and challenging question to you. Okay, so do you think that AI algorithm is going to replace the designer, or how designers adopt you know, the AI technology to help them?
Yeah, I don't think it's going to replace designers. Actually, there are certain media companies, including most recently The New Yorker, and also Bloomberg, that are replacing journalists with AI software. So they're very good at writing stories. But so far, AI software is not actually very good at designing clothes. But they are, you know, AI is great for creating tools that can make them a lot smarter about what and how they design. There's a particular field called predictive analytics, which is a kind of software that helps people figure out what people are actually going to buy, so that brands can create less products that ultimately aren't going to get sold, reduce waste, reduce costs.
Okay. So there's recent news about Forever 21. They've closed a lot of shops worldwide, right? So based on your observation, how do you see the perspective for the fast fashion in the coming years?
Yeah, so Forever 21 recently entered bankruptcy proceedings in the U.S. There's a lot of reasons for that, including the fact that they just didn't adapt to e-commerce very quickly, and the product wasn't as good or competitive as what was being produced by, you know, say, H&M and Zara. And then thirdly, they also launched too many new stores in too many markets simultaneously, and a lot of the stores weren't working, and they had to shutter them in a lot of markets. Forever 21 is not going away. they're going to restructure and downsize a little bit, but they will continue growing. I think with fast fashion, you know, there's a lot of concern at companies like H&M and Zara, especially about the backlash that's coming because of sustainability. So the question is, what can they do now to actually produce in a more ethical way, more sustainably, but also so that way that their brands aren't really damaged to this. So they're launching, recycling programs, donation programs. They're also starting to relook at their materials and create things that have less of an impact on the environment. And again, going back to predictive analytics, they're also using the software so they can start producing less. So ultimately, they're not going to have to put as much on sale and ultimately into landfill.
Okay. So even the 10 trends you share, What could be the you know the social media strategy that brand can adopt you know for their business in the future?
Yeah, I think there's so much exciting that's going on in social media right now. I mean, obviously these platforms are much more saturated than they were, so growing is a lot harder, or I should say, organic growth is a lot harder. It's a lot more expensive. You really got to pay to play. I think one of the more exciting things we've seen, particularly with Instagram, is the changing of the algorithm so that it doesn't just favor people who already have massive followings, but actually through a number of like new software developments, they're actually promoting new influencers with smaller followings that then those brands partner with them, they can then promote. So I think, again, like influencer strategy is so important. It's everything that the fashion brands are looking at, making sure that you have the right partners, that you're looking at the right metrics to make sure that those people are actually reaching your customers, and then you're seeing a return on that investment. Incredibly important. But I only really know about Instagram. Sorry.
All right. So my last question to you, because I'm going to close this section. Some of the questions will be, you know, discussed in the panel discussion. If you have, you know, raise your question here. So I'm not sure that if you're aware of Taiwan actually is very good at the textile. So the amount of the textile, you know, the clothing we imported outside of Taiwan is enormous. So how do you see Taiwan with the textile background and also with the creativity and skills from the designer, how Taiwan can be, you know, part of the global fashion community?
I mean, what I can tell you, I've been seeing demand particularly with textiles is again on like recycled and more sustainable fibers and innovation. It's been incredible to see companies like Allbirds actually working with textile companies and manufacturers to create new materials. Allbirds, for example, has gone to South America to create a new sort of sustainable sole that's made out of recycled sugarcane. So instead of using rubber, which you can recycle in the landfill, they create a rubber sole that's made out of sugarcane, and then they open source it, so actually any other brand can now work with this manufacturer. So I think partnering with companies that are doing really interesting things to invest in research and development, and then making sure that, you know, as part of that agreement, you can then bring that same technology to other brands. I mean, I'm not an expert in this, again, I apologize, but that to me seems like a real opportunity.
All right, so time's up. You can have a seat. Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing. Thank you. OK， 好的，我们刚刚听完了 Sharon 他对于整个 Global 在未来2020年的十个 Trend 之外呢，接下来我要花一点时间，大概五到六分钟，来跟大家分享一下台湾目前我们的时尚产业的一个现况。那么这个聚焦台湾市场的现况这件事情，大概是我在去年的时候很有一个机会呢，做的文化部的一个时尚产业大调查。所以呢，我访问过非常非常多的台湾设计师，还包括上中下游不同的厂商。所以呢，当我们再去了解国外的时候，我们可能也要先了解一下我们自己目前站在什么样的一个位置。首先呢，我想再跟呼应一下刚才Lawrence 说的哈，不管是说这个 AI 的影响，或者是这个永续的时尚这些的议题，事实上这些都成为我们在台湾所有设计师或者是时装服装界的一个很重要的议题。那么台北呢，我们在2018年时候正式加入了时装周的行列，所以各位我们真的非常荣幸，现在我们参加是第二届的一个时装周。那么所以呢，我不是很想说我们台湾从2018年才是一个时尚元年，其实我们很多的设计师、很多的品牌、很多时尚媒体早就在耕耘这个台湾市场，只是说我们从去年开始有一个正式的时尚周的平台，那我们也很高兴，就像是时尚论坛，去年是第一届，今年是第二届，也就是当在看时装周、时装秀的同时之外，我们也希望可以透过这些品牌有更多知识型的一个交流，促进整个产业从上游、中游、下游整体的一个发展。那么大家还可以看到一下，这个是我们2018年时尚这个产业的一个大转折。去年呢，我们有这个八个品牌、四个主场秀，结合60个以上的设计师举行一个联合的一个展演。所以呢，当大家都还在摸索的时候，当我们还是那么理解到整个时尚产业的这个结构的情况之下，先做了一个这样的一个尝试性。但是我自己个人的观察认为是，这对台湾的整体的时尚能量是有相当大的一个助力了。那最感谢的是，我们的政府的单位也意识到时尚不仅仅只是附属在所谓的纺织产业其中一环，因为过去呢，如果大家可能有关注到台湾的纺织产业，每年有3000亿以上的这样子一个产值，然后对国外的一个影响非常大的。但是如果我们拉回到时装设计品牌这件事情的时候呢，事实上过去的这个关注是稍微比较小的，所以过去在2018年这件事情，我们正式把它拿回来，当做一个台湾在所谓的设计时装上面的一个主轴。那么，我们可以来给大家看一下，这是一个时尚产业链。我可能今天没有太多时间，大概不外乎就是说，我们是要从最我的右手 边开始，就是说从时尚的设计服务开始，就是时尚产业的开头。接下来呢，我们必须要有一些生产制造的一个基地。那么生产完制造完之后，当然一定要有分销跟宣传，然后最后我们还需要有地方来陈列来销售。所以这整个的生态链，这整个的上中下游，它必须每一个环节都串接得非常好的时候呢，这个产业才能够真正的永续的发展。所以呢，我相信我们在座有很多的朋友也都去过，比如说像是首尔东大门，对不对？这就是一个很明显的一个产业链。那么目前在台湾的规模还没有可能到达那么大的一个情况。那但是呢，这些里面每一个产业的每一个链接的当中呢，如果它的联系程度够强烈，或者当中有断裂的情况的时候呢，我们的产业就会受到局限。那在过去我们采访过很多的台湾的设计师，都告诉我们很多的地方在台湾的断裂的部分其实是需要赶快的来进行修补的。那这个呢，是我跟大家做一个分享。这是目前从根据2018年文化创意这个产业发展年报的统计，就是台湾我们自己就是本地的时尚产业的产值的出估是505亿。这里面不含什么呢？不含所有国外的品牌，我们专注的是国内我们本地的设计师的品牌跟服务。但是大家会觉得很奇怪，这个数字怎么这么小，只有505亿。那我们访问过很多在台湾的这些设计师，包括了所谓的连锁这个时尚业的董事长，他告诉我说，两个他的这个公司就已经超过这个数字了。那为什么这个数字是这样的一个情况呢？这边有两个重要原因。第一个是我们去年才开始针对台湾时尚产业做初步型的产值调查，我们还没有做到普查的地步，所以呢，很多产业并没有纳入进去，这是第一个很重要的原因。第二个部分呢，目前在我们台湾的这个政府的产业的规格规划里头当中呢，某些产业呢，它没有把它算在时装产业。比如说大家可以看到广告公关或者是媒体策展模特这些，它可能都放在别的类别当中。所以因此呢，这个数字其实呢，我只能说，如果今天我们要讲1到10是台湾一个产业的一个调查的话，我们今天现在只做到1。所以呢，我们有很多的工作必须要完成。也就是说，当我们越了解我们自己本身的产业发展的一个状况的时候，大家在资源的运用，在相互横向的联系、纵向合作的时候，我们才有更大的能量可以出现。那接下来呢，大家可以来看到下一张图。这里面呢，是我们目前时尚的聚落。那我们另外有一个叫 T Fashion。它是一个时尚基地，也是去年才开始的。另外我们用 Fashion Walk， 它在花博。那另外还有我们在4月29服饰创作基地。那这些呢，这个服饰创作基地最主要呢，是给我们的设计师可以有一个协助他们做一些打样设计基础的一个空间。那另外两个部分就有点像我们的所谓的培育的摇篮的地方。那不过这些所在地目前来讲，它是分散在台北好几个地方，所以呢，我们只能说我们的聚落有一点点样子，但是呢，规模还真的还没有办法跟我们的邻近的像在韩国的状态来做一个比较。那么另外来讲呢，我们在各个不同的部会呢，也做了很多的一些投入，包括了我们台北市商业司，我们有做台北好时尚、台北 TOP 时装设计大赛。然后另外呢，我们在经济部工业局，我们有 TFDA 的时装设计新人奖。那此外呢，我们台北魅力展、台北 InStyle 呢，也是这个经济部的国贸局在协助的。所以呢，目前可以看到，从中央到地方，我们各自有不同的部会再来去协助所谓的时尚设计，可以往一个比较聚焦的一个方向来行走。那这里呢，我还是要说，虽然我们只是一个 baby 在学步，可是呢，我们有非常多的设计师已经走上国际舞台。这里面大家可以看到的，詹普在这个伦敦时装周。 那么黄薇 Jenny 她在伦敦时装周，另外呢夏姿是在这个巴黎时装周，然后还有呢张艺勋他也在巴黎的时装的男装的部分。那除此之外呢，除了这个巴黎跟这个伦敦之外呢，我们也有像是周瑜莹还有这个洞房张里，他们到上海时装周去参加区域型的时装周。那比较真的很值得鼓励，就是辅仁大学的织品系，他们有这个叫做他们的 Young Talent， 他们参加了这个伦敦时装周 Fashion Style， 就是童子军来培养这些学生往外走的一个能力。所以呢，这边呢，我只是很简单的用一点时间跟大家分享一下目前我们台湾的现状。我们真的需要所有在场的所有的朋友们，大家努力来支持我们的时尚时装产业的发展。我相信明年此时，我们可以看到更丰硕的一个成果。那这边呢，我就先告一段落，谢谢大家。好，那接下来呢，我要请接下来的另外 speaker 黄琦 Fashion Click 的创办人黄琦来到台上。黄琦呢，毕业于圣马丁大学，然后呢，后来他在硕士班的时候在皇家艺术学院。那其实呢，我要说，我看到他其实有一种很深的一个尊敬。因为之前黄琦自己是做品牌设计师，自己设计品牌，也在全球有所谓的这个时尚店，但是他后来毅然决然收了这样的 business， 转做所谓的时尚的医生。那我们来请他谈一下，是怎么样的一个转变呢？我们来请他的告白。
谢谢。我们啊，我要介绍自己刚才的都是一个比较 global 还有 macro 的 viewpoint。 那现在我来 share 一下我比较有 personal 的 fashion journey。 可能要先说一说影片。这个是我 David Nail 三大的那个香港海港对三大的那个红影中的影视地方绝对的安
創
對創作
的
人
係
一種
好
大嘅挫敗感，
好強引進香港需要有一個發達嘅旺
角。所以我哋就想通過 Daydream Nation 去捍衞翻呢啲發達嘅人。 所以这个就是我Daydream 从2006年开始跟弟弟做的一个品牌。其实很多人都会说，哦，你很幸运，赢在起跑线，就是因为也确实，我们很好得到妈妈的支持，可以到伦敦Saint Martin's 跟Royal College of Art 读书，这个帮了我们也不少。而且毕业的时候也，在毕业展里面给日本United Arrows 的买手店看中了，就买了我第一个 collection， 然后就慢慢开始跟弟弟一起做这个品牌，透过时装讲故事。那我们每一季就会带着我们自己做出来的 collection 到世界各地的时装周、trade show 去sell 我们的 collection， 而且也算很顺利。我们在很短时间里面就卖到10个不同的国家，100多家买手店这样。2010年就是一个turning point， 我们在国际上拿到不同的奖awards， 在意大利 Vogue Italia 给了我们一个Vogue Talent 的 award， 然后我们也跟不同的国international brands 合作，像 Peter Jensen 啊，Urban Outfitters 啊，很多很多不同的合作。然后我们也开了我们第一间flagship store， 在香港湾仔的永丰街，然后就在湾仔的艺术中心，然后尖沙咀的 K11， 都一切都像很顺利。但是当然这个不是一个 happily ever after 的故事。在2013年，我弟弟决定他要全full time 去做音乐，所以他就说我不做时装了。然后那个时候我觉得还好，有我男朋友一位在帮我很多，这3家店都是他设计的。他是一个很厉害、很有名的舞台设计师，但是unfortunately 在2014年1月，他突然间急性白血病离开了，在3天呢就离开了，所以我的世界从那一刻开始就完全崩破了，完全改变了。这个就是我跟他最后的合照。但是在这个很迷失的时候，我其实也继续坚持做这个品牌多2年，因为还有团队，我们很爱的团队。但是在最后这2年里面，我们也感受到fast fashion 对我们的影响，就是我们客人都会要求我们要多做一点款，快一点，便宜一点。这个时候我觉得很累。还有就是我不可能再不断的要求我们的 factory 价钱要低一点，所以我就在这个时候报了一个Young Design Talent Award， 那也很幸运的我得到了这个 award， 可以离开香港1年。这个时候就是决定我要不再做这个品牌的时候了。所以那个就是我们一个close studio 之前的一个 poster， 然后那个就是我们 studio 最后pack away 之后就空了。然后我就拿着这个 Young Design Talent Award 就到了北欧的 Copenhagen， 我在哪里就跟Henry Fitzgoff 就是当地最有名的设计师工作。在北欧我慢下来之后也学到了简单生活是什么。然后在这个 studio 里面我遇到一个很有趣的女生，她叫 Lenka， 来自波兰。她除了是一个很 extreme 的 vegan 之外，也是一个 environmental activist， 然后我看到他身上做了这些学纹身，是吓了一跳。我问你怎么要这样做？他纹的都是一些大牌子，还有 fast fashion 的 logos。他说，fast fashion is so bad it hurts。这个之后，我们谈了很多关于时装工业背后在发生什么事。我也看了很多的纪录片，就像这个 The True Cost， 我真的感受很深。因为从中缅的农夫在印度，其实每30分钟他们就会有一个会喷农药自杀，就是因为他们压力很大。卖种子给他们的人也是，卖农药给他们的人也是他们的地主，也是最终如果他们生 cancer 的话，也是卖 cancer 药给他们的人。当然也有其他 factory 里面工作的的工人会患上皮肤癌啊。当然还有2013年在 Bangladesh 发生的这个 tragedy。都是出于商人的贪念，他们因为订单太多，所以就要加2成在这个 factory 上面。然后工人都知道工厂会塌下来，但是manager 还是叫他们要继续做，因为他们有 deadline。所以这天那天就有1100人在。这个 factory collapse 的时候lost their lives。 所以看了很多很沉重的事情之后，我也很多 statistics， 就是知道时装是世界第二最 polluting 的 industry 啊，就很多不同的 statistics 啊。香港就是每分钟都会掉出1000件 T-shirts。那这个时候，在这个大前提之下，我觉得我需要一个 fashion detox。然后我就用了这一年在北欧的时候，在走访欧洲不同国家的不同城市，去看看到底有没有一些新的想法，还有新的 innovation， 就是 for a sustainable future。这个我在 Dutch Design 遇到 Lucy Majors， 他的 project 叫 Human Ivory， 他觉得我们为什么要拿象的牙来做 accessories？ 他说人我们自己也有牙的，所以他就问他的牙医给一些人家脱了的牙去打磨成好像珍珠一样。所以他给你的 service 就是你有如果有broken teeth， 你可以给他，他可以帮你做成你的新的 accessories。 然后 Carmen Yosa， 刚才 Lauren 也有提到的Pinatex， 就是因为我们经常吃菠萝，其实不知道会剩下很多 pineapple leaves。那他就用这个用了10年时间去研发，将这个菠萝剩下来的叶去做了一个 leather alternative。那还有这个 Hotel Vermont 就是来自法国的一个设计师，他在法国里面走遍不同的酒店去拿他们不要的一些 interior fabrics。或者像 curtains 啊 bed sheets 啊，就做出他的新的 collection。 还有就是来自 Switzerland 的 Freitag， 他们就是看到他们的 transport industry 里面这些货车用来包着 truck tops 也是很多浪费，所以他们就用了这个材料去做他们的袋子。所以我就想到，其实时装工业里面这么多浪费的东西，我们是不是要想一下，到底这些我们以为是 trash 的东西，其实是不是资源呢？ 所以机具有很多不同的品牌，像 Patagonia， 他们也有这个很 comprehensive 的 sustainable program。就像他们的 repair truck 会在美国，到不同城市帮他们的客人去修补他们的衣服。然后回香港之后，我就决定我不想再用 virgin material 去创作。这是我第一个就是 art collection， 就是在当卖 collect 了很多天鹅羽毛。就是掉下来的，然后也是人家不要的 yarns 跟vintage frames， 就是做出了我第一个art collection from the zero waste art collection Fight or Flight。 然后继续也是像回香港会做不同的工作坊，教人家如何修补衣服啊，talks saving clothes from the landfill sale， 做不同的纪录片的 screenings。然后在不同的舞台啊、舞蹈啊、演唱会啊、电影都会用这个方法去创作，这些全都是用人家不要 abandoned surface material 去做的设计。然后这个就是 was commissioned by London Craft Week。我用 Daydreamation 品牌剩下来的material 去做了一个 collection。 这个像湖人骨的一个 structure 是用我们的wooden hangers 改装出来变成这个 artwork 的，这些也是用剩下来的布料中出，这个叫 Fashion Anatomy 的 collection。 因为觉得这个时装工业真的很病态，我们的时装的内脏都有点rotten。 在这个时候我遇到我现在的 partner Toby， 我们的想法都很一致。他做 upcycling 已经做了6年，所以我觉得我们就觉得应该要一起做 upcycling 这件事情。然后我们就 create 了 fashion clinic， 因为我们觉得时装工业有病，我们要变成一个时装医生。我们希望去 heal the industry, the closet, and finally the heart。 这个是一个 water health record card。 我们客人来的时候我们就会帮他们填日子啊，那冰冷就是他们的衣服save 了几件这样子。然后我们个人方面我们有 repair, reshape, redesign 的服务。Repair 就是一些简单的修补，就是用不同的 darning 的手法修化或者是 surgical stitching 这样子。Reshape 就是一些简单的长短扩窄的改动。然后 redesign 是 magic 一点的，就像这个是他客人老公的雪上变成一件 pregnancy dress， 然后这个是客人男朋友的牛仔裤变成了他的外套。然后这个是香港独立音乐人 Little Ashes， 他们每年到不同的颁奖典礼的 outfit， 就是从一件trench coat 变出来，每年帮他们再变再变，就创了3年了。除了 individual service 这个也是 individual service， 我们会帮客人去 rearrange 跟 restyle 他们的 wardrobe 的。所以我们会跟也在 individuals 以外，也会跟不同的品牌啊公司去合作，做 sustainability 的 projects。像 K11 啊，帮 Hyson Place upcycle 他们的 uniforms 啊，帮买手店去 upcycle 他们的 dead stock。当然也有跟不同的音乐人去
upcycle 他们的商台的衣服。然后这个是我们做了一个 poster， 因为我们希望大家可以跟你们的衣服做一生的朋友，就透过不同的 re 啊，就 rethink、rearrange、repair、reshape、redesign、reconnect、reexperience。那做了一年之后，我们觉得我们的力量很小，但是我们希望做的东西是比较多的，所以我们想到希望连接世界各地来的一些 sustainable fashion people， 所以我们想到想做一个 sustainable fashion festival。那因为我们相信 the future of fashion is about choosing well, buying smart, and experiencing more to close the loop of the consumption cycle， 所以我们的 festival 就叫 Future Fashion Lab。 然后现在有一个影片可以让大家理解一下。
香港 Tony 创立了 Fashion Clinic， 你好，这个都是在想一些方案啦，怎样可以平衡可以做得到，如何在这个市场啦，同埋相关嘅经验，我哋嗰个系需要去逆转呢个市场。
喺个个钟头嘅 event 处理过超过7000件嘅衣物啦，经过几百日拣剩嘅衫，究竟会系啲乜嘢咧？
咁其實 Fashion Clinic 喺成個 Fashion Cycle 裏面扮演嘅角色咧，係一個關於 re-experience 嘅角色啦。咁所以我哋就會透過不同嘅 redesign 嘅 project 啦，同埋 workshop 啦，希望透過創意咧，去鼓勵大眾同佢哋嘅舊衫做一世嘅朋友嘅。
I believe a long, lasting brand should be a category, a platform where all the interactions occur among diverse people with different materials and at an exacting location. A platform that allows to collaborate with lots of talented and unique designers than anyone can be.
我覺得 Cosmos 做緊嘢就係不停咁推緊自己嗰個 limit on 可以點樣做咧。可能兩年前我哋用嘅 material 只係 design concept。到今日我哋行選入用嘅係我哋回收膠樽、用回收 cotton、回收竹。
I've recuperated fabric from hotels, old curtains, bedsheets, tablecloth, napkins, and just made unusual pieces with them. So sometimes you just have to adjust the pattern to the fabric, but that makes them even more unique and one of a kind.
My production process, so I actually mainly use organic cotton and also surplus fabrics. And our whole process, you know, we try to focus on fair trade, so all our workers are being paid a fair wage. And we also produce in small quantities so that we do not waste, like we don't have dead stock laying around as much as, you know, big brands do.
There's many ways of doing upcycling. You can actually use materials that exist, and then you can integrate them into your design, or you can use the material and by craft you can transform them.
咁我哋嘅諗法就係可以按照消費者需要啲乜嘢而按demand咁樣做嘅話，就可以解決到好多生產上面嘅問題。希望就係可以即係對個
Over the years, I've built up an extensive knowledge of traditional repair techniques which are used in new and unexpected ways. I celebrate an outstanding patch of style by making it stand out.
全部將它變回沙，再織回線，再用一個 3D 的紡織的方法咧，將佢變翻一件衣服，就即係變咗一個新嘅科技嘅系統，但係擺喺一個傳統嘅行業裏
面。I'm really trying now to connect, especially smaller brands that have interesting strong actions with respect to sustainability, and connect them to customers in Hong Kong.
香港作为一个international city，它应该要有自己的sustainable fashion festival，希望透过future fashion来去重新定义时装是什么样。那所以我们十一月就很兴奋，因为预备了八年时间。 在最后找到我们的title sponsor DBS，就帮我们整件事情变得可以比较decent。所以这个十天的 festival 我们会有documentary screenings 啊，talks panel discussions 展览，还有 workshops 这样子。主要是因为我们觉得。很多人都会对这个 eco fashion 的 green 或者是 green fashion 有一点的误会，觉得你 green fashion upcycling 是不是is it about rubbish or just stuff you don't want？ 但是我真的觉得，其实有很多设计师 sustainable fashion designers 做得很好，非常厉害，而且是很。quality 做得真的很好，所以我们这个future fashion呢，就是也是一个回应，对于这个severely sick fashion industry的一个回应。所以就有展览部分，还有education部分。我们相信 good design endures， and good design is not to be wasted。 所以你刚才看到的品牌都会出现在我们的展览里面，大概30个来自世界各地跟香港的 sustainable fashion label， 我们都觉得是做的最好的一些独立品牌，像韩国的 Recode， Switzerland 的 Freitag， 法国的 Fasia， 这个法国的 Hotel Vetements， 当然还有一些比较。innovation 的人，好像 Diana Scherer 是来自荷兰的一个，他觉得植物的根部其实非常聪明，所以他教这个植物生出一个 legs 的 root， 所以他现在已经develop 到再生一件衣服出来，还有 Susanne 就是用这个捆去生。 它的 material 出来，就是因为这个布料跟 leather 也很像，所以也是有其他方法去做布料的。然后这个 来自 Denmark 的，就是用真的用 rubbish 去做它的 artwork 的。然后这些都是刚才有提过的一些品牌，还有伦敦的 Fashion Revolution 啊，还有。 就是像 Margiela 也是用了很多 upcycling 的方法去创作，还有 Victor and Rolf 也在这个高光时间 Haute Couture 里面也会用它的剩余的 material 去做，当然也是最后也会有我们有 screening 啊 ，The True Cost 啊 ，Tomorrow 啊 ，Workshops 等等。 但是我想说到最后，其实，我们其实每天在这个地球上面都是不断的拿东西，我们无论是在时装工业里面，或者是一个 consumer， 我们都有这个责任去想一想，我们到底是不是可以是时候还给这个地球，用我们的 consumer power to make a better world。 谢谢。
谢谢黄琦，拜拜。 Now's Q&A time. 黄琦呢，就是我很 surprise 他的国语讲得很好，
对不起，
其实我说我们在香港其实常常是国语、英语、粤语混着讲的，所以你刚刚很习惯，我很习惯听下夹下粤语，夹下英语，夹下国语。OK， 所以一样，我们请我们现场的朋友们可以扫一下 QR code， 看有什么问题。那在这同时呢，我想先问黄琦问题。If you cannot really, you know, answer in Mandarin, English is okay, Cantonese is okay. I can translate Cantonese for you. 因为你摆脱了经营品牌、养人、店租的这些压力，然后你专心的转型，然后做这个 upside 的一个研发。那我想要知道一下，就是说，你有没有一些建议可以给我们的设计师？因为可能不是每一个人都会是这样一条路的。那你给他们一些建议好吗？
我其实觉得，身为现在这个年代的设计师，其实有很多 alternatives， 就像我们到底是不是需要最每一季的 collection， 到底需不需要做一个一整个 collection， 就是真的需要100件100个款吗？我们是不是可以做到单品这样去出不是 collection 吧，就是改变一下这个方式，就是大家你啊跟大自然跟工人跟工厂都可以健康一点，用多点时间去做好一个设计，可能这个设计就会可以比较长久，或者是也有很多方法了，就是 upcycle 的方法，找比较 sustainable 的 material rental 的方法，就是不一定是要用到virgin material。
好，我觉得这是一个很重要的概念，就是我们怎么样运用既有的资源，可以极大化的使用。那这边呢，我们一个问题要问啊，我觉得这都不容易回答。请问这样的一级在乎 repair 模式，真的可以获利吗？你要怎么 make profits？ You know, you use redesign, you know, reshare. How can you make sure that you can keep your business working and sustainable？
我觉得来自韩国的 Recode， 他们其实是一个很好的例子。那当然，他们背后是有一个很大的
集团
、然后他们是其实有七家 fashion shops 的 corporation， 所以他们就有一个比较稳定的一个supply of unwanted material， 然后他们每一个 collection 全都是 upcycle 的，然后已经做了6年，我觉得他们的quality 跟 design 是做得很好，而且是一个很 comprehensive 很完整的一个 upcycle 的 process。
OK， 那这边呢，我们观众还有请问你，就是说这样的服务是不是一般的一些 customer 一般民众都可以使用？然后呢，像有些人可能很习惯，就是每一季 fast fashion 都要买东西，那你怎么样协助改变他们这样的习惯跟想法？
其实我看过最大 impact 的是日本的一个organizing guru， 叫 Maria Kondo。 其实我跟他的方法去 organize 我的 wardrobe 之后，我就觉得，因为他教我们的第一个方法就是将全家里面的所有的衣服一次过拿出来，这个其实是很 shocking 的，因为我也身为一个 fashion designer， 我也 collect 很多东西，所以我就觉得其实很多东西我都忘记了，其实是在 wardrobe 里面。然后 reorganize 过之后，我就知道我有太多东西，其实是需要 edit rather than add。然后你 edit 过之后，其实你看到你有什么，就不会再买不需要的衣服。而且有一个概念叫 cost for wear。就是你其实买衣服回来的价钱除开这个你穿多少次，就会有一个每次穿的价钱，所以如果你买了衣服回来根本没有穿过就比较贵。
yeah. 我觉得今天其实呢，我们在座包括我们都要学会做一件事情，可能大家今天回去之后给自己一个 mission， 在一个礼拜之内把你所有的全家的衣服全部导出来之后呢，可能要用 Excel 拍照，然后你要去计算你穿了几次，然后知道它的 return of investment， 它的这个效果到底好不好，你就知道到底要不要再花钱再买衣服了， right？
嗯，还有这个时候也是，如果是 fast fashion 比较 quality， 第一个的衣服你穿的比较少嘛，
对，
或者是很快就会破，
对。
但是如果你买一件好 quality 的衣服，你就可以穿很长时间，
对。Okay。好，那因为时间已经差不多接近12:20了，我们下午的场次12:40会开始，所以呢，我们就先在这边告一段落。其他没有被回答的问题，我们尽量在 panel discussion 时候来满足大家。先谢谢各位今天上午的参与，谢谢大家。
谢谢，非常感谢我们 Lauren 博士以及黄琦。